Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Deepika Gupta and I'm here today with you on an academy platform, and we'll start, and our aim is to crack NEET PG. So let me tell you a little about myself. Just a second, sorry. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I did my MBBS and my MD in Obstetrics and Gynecology from AIIMS New Delhi. And I recently completed my MCH in Surgical Oncology from Kidwai Cancer Institute, Bangalore. So yes, I understand the grind of medical exams. I've written multiple MCQ entrance exams myself. And I can understand what are the problems you face and what is the help you need for cracking your next exam. So I hope I can use my personal academic experience and help you out. So the first thing that you need to do is to download this wonderful Unacademy learning app. Get the app. It opens and brings to you many, many educators who are doing very well in their fields, both professionally, academically, and who have taken out tremendous time and effort so that you may also excel in your next exam. So you have different batches coming up. You can, depending upon where you are in your preparation, which exam you are targeting, whether it is this NEET PG in April 2021 or you are targeting the next year exam. So according to that, there are different batches. Choose your batch, make the right choice. So there are two subscriptions which are available. One is the Plus subscription, which brings to you the live classroom experience. Okay. And the second is the Iconic subscription, which brings to you both the live classroom of Unacademy as well as the pre-recorded content of PrepLadder. There are so many, many notes and videos, procedures, images, everything that you can see. All of which has been thoroughly researched and put over there, keeping in mind the changing trend of the examination. So you can to get the subscription, you can use my code Dr. Deepika, and which will get you a 10% discount. See, it is preferable to you choose your duration as per your preparation. If you are an intern, you can take a 1 year subscription. If you are a third year student, you can take a 3 year 24 month subscription or a 36 month subscription, right? And my code Dr. Deepika will get you a 10% discount on that. So coming to today's topic, cervical cancer screening and prevention. Okay, so why is we will discuss screening under the following headings: why, how, when, what are other preventive strategies, and one more diagnostic modality, that is colposcopy. So let's come to the first thing. What is the definition of screening? Screening is basically a test or which is easily applicable, and you put it on apparently healthy people, asymptomatic, right? This is not people who are coming to your clinic saying that I'm having bleeding or I'm having this pain, that pain, nothing like that. This is done in the community for people who are apparently healthy without any symptoms. Okay. So that you can identify disease in such patients. It might be an advanced disease which you might pick up, or it might be a early stage disease that you might pick up. Now, it is not a diagnostic test. It is not a basis for definitive treatment. Why I have put these two lines here? This is very important for understanding the importance of any screening test, whether it is in cervix or whether it is in any other cancer or for matter any other disease. So it does not form a basis for definitive treatment. It should be easily applicable. It should be acceptable to patients. It should be reproducible. That is, every time you do it, results should coincide. And it should be accurate. So now that we have understood what is the meaning of screening, we go to cervical cancer screening. So why do we screen a patient for CA cervix? See, a normal cervix will acquire HPV, that is your human papilloma virus, which is supposed to be the most common cause of developing cervical cancer, right? Now this patient has developed HPV infection. She might clear out the infection, okay, on her own, depending upon her own immunity, or there may be some factors which will help in persistence of this infection. What are these factors? We will understand later. But there are certain factors which are causing persistence of this dangerous virus, HPV. Now that this HPV is persisting, it can lead to pre-malignant disease or precursor lesions, as we call them. Example, CIN, that is cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. So in simple language, what is this pre-malignant disease? That there are changes which are associated in the cells which are suggestive of cancer. Okay, like that there may be nuclear enlargement, nucleus is becoming big, chromatin is getting clumped. Okay, then there may be more mitotic figures. That is, certain changes are there, but whatever these changes, they are confined up to the basement membrane. They are not going beyond this basement membrane. If it goes beyond, then it is invasive carcinoma. Okay, so what is important to us in this is that this entire cycle from normal cervix to invasive cancer is taking 10 to 30 years sometimes. Or we can say 10 years or more. So this gives us such a long period where we can identify a disease. Okay, you know that CIN has different types 1, 2, 3. The details of which we will discuss in the next class, that is tomorrow's class, right? But we know that from normal to pre-malignant and to finally to invasive cancer is taking a long time, and we can intervene in this time, right? So if we intervene, what will happen? It has been seen in so many studies, particularly in the developed nations, that the incidence of CA cervix has decreased, right? I told you yesterday also that in the West, in the developed countries, endometrial cancer is the most common genital malignancy. Cervix has drastically reduced and the incidence has reduced by almost 80%. Mortality has also reduced due to CA cervix. Okay. Now, why has it reduced? It has reduced because we are detecting lesions at very early stage, at CIN1, CIN2, and treating them also. So, mortality has also reduced by 60%. But sadly, in our country, since we have not been able to put up screening programs on a very large level, despite a lot of efforts being made, CA cervix is still the most common genital malignancy, and we have not been able to cover all our women under this screening program. So that is why screening is very important. So any asymptomatic healthy lady, we should subject her to this screening. What age group, how to screen, we will discuss next. So now, how to screen? I have given you a list of investigations. The first is cytology, right? You all know what is cytology, that is the pap smear. Everybody is aware, you have definitely seen it in the gynecopedy, pap smear, right? It can be conventional, it can be liquid based. Then there are some methods known as VIA or VILI. What is VIA? VIA is visualization under acetic acid. VILI is visualization under Luger's iodine. Then other test is your high-risk HPV testing. And last is co-testing. That is a combination of the two. That is cytology and high-risk HPV. So now why I have put this list here, you know, they may ask you an MCQ. Which of these is a screening modality for CA cervix? And they can put in one extra option for you. Three options may be out of this, and one extra option may be colposcopy. Let me clarify it here only. Colposcopy is not a screening modality, right? Colposcopy is done in certain specific situations and indications. It helps us to make a diagnosis. It is not meant that you will subject an entire population to colposcopy. So let us go into detail about each of these tests, because repeatedly questions are being asked on these topics. So I have put two pictures for you. The first is the pap smear and the second is your liquid based cytology. So what do you do in a pap smear? See, a woman has come to you and she is 35 years of age, and you want to do screening and you have pap smear available. You are in a government hospital. You have the first one, that is the conventional pap smear bottle available with you, right? So what will you do? You will make her lie down in the dorsal position. You will insert the cusco speculum, right? Then you are going to use this spatula. This is known as the Ayer spatula, A-Y-R-E, right? This is the Ayer spatula, which has an end like this. So in your exam, if you get a photo, you should remember this is the Ayer spatula. we will put the cuscus, visualize the cervix, then we will put this end of the Ayer's patella at the ectocervix and take a scraping. Simple. Okay. Then the second is your endocervical brush. What do you do with the endocervical brush? You will insert it inside the endocervix and rotate it just a quarter. A quarter rotation will take the cells full 360 degree. Then you will coat this on a slide. Okay. And then this slide is put into this jar, which is known as the Copeland's jar. What does this jar contain? This jar contains 95% ethyl alcohol, which is a fixative. Now, see what is, I told you that these are cytology studies. So in cytology, what you are doing is like, suppose this is a surface, you just take one superficial scrape like this, right? So, and then you visualize these individual cells under the microscope. That's a cytology. But how is it different from a biopsy? In biopsy, you take a small chunk of the tissue. Okay. Depending upon how much depth you have taken, you can see different layers. So, and that then staining will also be different. Appearances are different. Then second comes your LBC. That is the liquid-based cytology. Okay. This was the conventional cytology. This is the liquid-based cytology. Now, this is the brush that is used. What is the advantage of this brush? See, in one brush only, it has a pointed end, which is longer, and this will go inside the endocervix. Okay? And this part, the shorter part, will go and take a scraping from the ectocervix. Then, we will go and open this bottle, the thin prep bottle that you can see here, and you will shake this brush inside. Okay? It's like a James Bond martini. It is shaken. You just shake it and the cells will dislodge from this plastic and go and rest inside the fixative. What is the fixative that is used here? It is the methanol. Right? So, this is the procedure of taking both the smears. So, let's come to a little bit detail. So, conventional pap smear, I told you, Ayer's patula is there, endocervical brush is there, fixative is 95% ethyl alcohol. Now, what is importance of these tests? How sensitive they are, how specific they are, what is the false negative? So, what do you understand by sensitivity? Sensitivity is the ability to diagnose the disease, all those who have the disease. So, a test, a screening test ideally, should have a very good sensitivity. But pap smear, if you see, doesn't have very higher sensitivity. It is somewhere around 55 to 60%. Okay? And false negative I have mentioned here. What is false negative? That is, a patient is having a disease, but your test is telling that it is no, patient is normal, patient does not have a disease. So, this is a very problematic report, because you will tell the patient you don't have the disease, but actually, your test was giving a false negative. So, the false negative value is as high as 15 to 30%. That's why what we do a pap smear repeatedly at a fixed interval, maybe 3 yearly or 5 yearly, depending upon what other tests are being clubbed with it. That's why we do a repetition of the false negative. And second thing is, that's why we focus so much on the technique. Maybe you have not taken the endocervical scraping properly. Okay, maybe the vagina is very dry, cells are not being shed, for example, in a postmenopausal woman. So, you might need to give her some estrogen ointment and then you might need to take the pap smear. So, you need to minimize your false negatives. That is, you don't want to assure a patient that you are perfectly normal when she actually might have some disease. So, that is the importance, and that's why I'm focusing so much on the false negative. Now you have understood, I showed you the Ayer's patula, the endocervical brush, then there are different type of brushes which are available. Then comes your liquid-based cytology. You use a plastic spatula, I showed you, with the fixative is buffered methanol. Now what is the advantage of this liquid-based cytology? See, when we are coating the slide in a conventional slide, many layers of cells will overlap each other. And your pathologist might say that it is very difficult and I am not able to make out any cells, individual cells in these. right? And whereas cytology is completely dependent upon observing the architecture of each type of cell. So now you've taken the smear, patient has gone home, but the report has come that it is unsatisfactory or it is inadequate, I am not able to make out. So then came the role of liquid-based cytology. In liquid-based cytology, individual cells are washing off the plastic brush, right? So they are not coating. Then they are passed through a filter and then a slide is made, right? So that means you have a thin prep bottle, right? Here this has certain cells which are present in it. It is put in a very sophisticated filter. I am just drawing a filter like this for you. The cells will go through this and then they are going to be plated on a slide, right? So the chance of seeing individual cells is better. It is better appreciated. Then second thing is that it also has some mucolytic and hemolytic agents in it. The fixative also has some hemolytic agents. So if there is blood, excess of blood is present in the smear, that is also one cause of inadequate pap smear. So this hemolytic agent will lyse the red blood cell. Similarly, mucolytic agent will lyse the mucus and it will lead to decreased unsatisfactory results. So this is one advantage. Okay. Second advantage is that you have the solution. You did a cytology and you got a result which is a little tricky, or it is not exactly normal, it is not very high risk. You want to do a further testing like the HPV testing. So you can use the same sample. You do not need to take another separate sample from the lady. Similarly, you can test for other STDs like gonorrhea and chlamydia. The disadvantage is that the cost is higher and that's why it is not available in all setups. So now we come to visual inspection methods. Okay, so what are these visual inspection methods? The cervix is right in front of you. You are doing a naked eye examination. You feel it looks maybe a little abnormal, or it relatively looks normal. You are not able to make out. But how do you supplement this naked eye examination? You can apply certain substances like acetic acid or Ugel's iodine. This is a very effective method in low resource settings, right? And particularly in the Indian setup, it can be very, very useful, where you can train your ANMs or you can train the paramedical health workers and you can ask them to simply do a visual inspection and send this. If anything they find abnormal, they can either take a biopsy or they can refer the patient to a higher setup. The advantage is that you can make an immediate diagnosis and there is a possibility of simultaneous treatment if the expertise is available or if you have a cryotherapy machine. Now, I have told you that written the drawback is the lower specificity. Okay, and it is not reliable in postmenopausal women. Why? In postmenopausal women, what happens is the transformation zone. Okay, the transformation zone is going inside the endocervix, right? Transformation zone is the zone where maximum dysplasia and CIN and cancer is arising. Now, if this has gone inside the cervix, endocervix, see, let me just draw a picture for you. See, this is your cervix, right? Normally, in a young lady or a reproductive age group lady, the transformation zone will be here. Whereas in a postmenopausal lady, it will be here, or it might go even further up. So now what do? You are not able to visualize it. So therefore, this method is not very useful in a postmenopausal woman. But advantage is that false negative is very low. That means false reassurance is very low in this. Okay. So you will not make the mistake of telling a patient that she doesn't have any problem, even if she does have it. So now what do we do in a VA, that is a visualization under acetic acid? It's a simple technique. You apply your same Cusco speculum, then you apply 3-5% acetic acid and wait for 1 minute. What does acetic acid do? It will go and cause reversible coagulation of the nuclear protein. So dysplastic cells, I told you. What was the changes of dysplasia? I told you that there is going to be an increased nuclear size, right? Nuclear hyperchromasia will be there. That clumping of chromatin will be there. Increased mitotic figures will be there. Increased nuclear to cytoplasmic ratio will be there. right? Since all these cells are there, all this increased nuclear content means increased proteins. And this increased protein will be coagulated by the acetic acid, and then it will be visible as a white intensity or a acetovite area, as you can see in the figure, right? These acetovite areas can be seen. So this in this figure, it is simple. It is just telling you, see, light is coming in and it is going here, right? This is the epithelium. If it is a dysplastic epithelium, more nuclear content is there, more light is being absorbed. When we are applying acetic acid to it, what will it cause? It will cause reversible coagulation, and this entire light will be absorbed and an acetovite area will be visible. Second comes visualization under Liouville's iodine. Now, in a normal epithelium, what happens is, a normal squamous epithelium, the superficial cells, the intermediate cells, they are laden with glycogen. This glycogen will react with the iodine, okay? Glycogen plus iodine that you have added, and it will lead to a mahogany brown color. This color, you can see in the periphery, this is the mahogany brown color. Now, the abnormal epithelium, that is the dysplastic epithelium, it does not have glycogen. So, it will not stain this mahogany brown color, rather it will show you a mustard yellow staining. It is said that this yellowing or this brown color changes are better appreciated than the white color changes. So this is also a simple, easy method, can be done in your low resource settings. It gives a visual description, and you can also take a biopsy from the abnormal area. Next comes HPV testing. Now this is like a Pandora's box. Every year questions are being asked from HPV, human papilloma virus. Just to remember a little microbiology, it belongs to the papilloma virus family, right? Papilloma viridae. I hope the spelling is right. Then it is a non-enveloped double-stranded DNA virus, right? There are many types, more than 100 types. 30 to 40 are anogenital, that they will go and infect the anal and the genital mucosa. There are some oncogenic types, that is the high risk, and there are some non-oncogenic types, that is the low risk. So we are familiar with four numbers: 611, 1680. 611 is the low risk. What does this low risk do? It will cause anogenital warts. Okay, then it will cause, sometimes this wart will grow and will form the condyloma acuminata. It is a large cauliflower shaped wart. Third is, it can also cause laryngeal papillomatosis. That is why in a woman who is having active genital warts, we do not allow normal delivery, because the child may get infected with the HPV virus and develop a laryngeal papillomatosis. Then there are high risk types: 16, 18, 31, 33, 35, 39, so on. So many are there. Now we need to remember certain things about these viruses. So 16, let me tell you about 16. This is most commonly associated with CA cervix. Okay. Almost 55%. 18 is second most commonly associated. But this is most specific. Why most specific? See, 16 positivity may be seen in other patients also, like those who are having CIN1, or they might not be actually having any pathology. But 18 is very, very closely knit either with CIN3 or higher lesions or invasive CA. Okay, that's why 18 is said to be more specific. Then it is seen to be associated with adenocarcinoma of the cervix, whereas 16 is associated with squamous cell carcinoma more, right? 16 and 18. Together, they are responsible for 70% of CA cervix. And HPV in all is responsible for 99% of CA cervix. So why all these numbers I am telling you? See, CA cervix, this is one of the cancers that is caused by a virus. We know the etiology. Otherwise, most of your times, patient will come and ask, why did I develop this cancer? For example, lung cancer. Patient might come to you and say, I never smoked, but I got lung cancer. But for CA cervix, you actually do have an answer that yes, it could be due to 99%, it is due to a virus, that is HPV virus. We know how this spreads. We know how to prevent it. That's why it is so important. And 70%, that is the major bulk, is caused by 16 and 18 alone, right? 16 is most common and more associated with squamous cell carcinoma. 18 is more specific and associated with adenocarcinoma. Each of these lines is a MCQ. Please remember. So now, how does this virus spread? It spreads through sexual contact. Condom use will reduce the risk, but it is also spreading through non-sexual routes like vertical transmission from mother to a newborn, or also it is said it might spread through fomites. So now what happens? How does the HPV infect? See, during sexual activity, there might be a small tear, right? A small tear, and the virus will find its way in. And go, see, you can see in the figure, the virus has gone in and straight gone down to the basal cell. So this HPV virus will go and infect the basal cell directly. From any genital trauma, the virus will go down and go and infect the basal cell. Now, once it has gone inside the basal cell, it may survive separately from the main cell DNA. In that case, it is called as an episome. Okay, it is not gone and integrated with the host DNA and is not actively replicated. Now, what happens is that there are two genes which will get dysregulated suddenly, and that will lead to this integration of the viral DNA into the host DNA and continuous replication. Now, why does that happen? See, HPV has gone and infected. Most of us, 80 to 90% of us, will clear out that infection on our own on the basis of our own immunity. But if the person is immunocompromised, has HIV, is smoking, or there are other STDs like HIV or herpes infection, then in that case, it gets potentiated. And what happens is that there is expression of E6 and E7 genes. This is going to dysregulate the cell cycle completely. And finally, your cancer will develop. So, now, how do we see the effect of HPV? We are taking the pap smear, we are doing biopsies. What will you see on your slide? See, in the cytology slide, this is going to be your view. And in the pathology slide, this is going to be your view. So, this is known as the cytopathic effect of the virus. Cytopathic effect of virus, which leads to development of a cell called as a coelocyte. What is a coelocyte? See, it has a perinuclear halo. There is a perinuclear clearing. You can see around the nucleus, there is a perinuclear clearing. There is a nuclear hyperchromasia. There is increased size of the nucleus. There is chromatin clumping. All this you are seeing, these kind of cells are seen in your pap smear. That means yes, some dysplastic changes have happened. Similarly, if you see on the pathology slide, your coelocyte is going to appear like this. You might get an image asking what is, so at least you should be able to make out that this is a cytology slide, this is a pathology slide, and they are asking you about coelocytes, that is the cytopathic effect of HPV virus. So now, just let us recall quickly, it is a double-stranded DNA virus. It has many genes, early genes. E1 and E2 are associated with the replication. That is, they are required for normal replication of the virus. When there is loss of this E1, okay, E1 is lost, then this virus will go and integrate with the host DNA, okay. Finally, there is going to be expression of the two major devils in our scenario, that is E6 and E7. Now, what do these do? See, E6 will go and act on P53. You know this is a tumor suppressor gene. okay, wherever there is more cell damage, this is going to cause apoptosis, that is natural cell death will occur. But when p53 is mutated by the E6, then in that case there is no cell cycle break, no apoptosis is happening, and therefore all this DNA damage will keep on accumulating and that will lead to cancer. Then second is the E7. This will go and affect the retinoblastoma gene, RB. This is also a tumor suppressor gene. What is the function of this retinoblastoma gene? This keeps an inhibitory effect on the E2F, that is the elongation factor. Okay? This is going to, now when this retinoblastoma gene is mutated, this inhibitory effect will be lost and there is going to be uncontrolled cellular proliferation. Uncontrolled cellular proliferation. That is the hallmark of neoplasia, right? P53, there is going to be accumulation of DNA damage, right? So now you have understood how HPV is spreading, what kind of a virus it is, what are the oncogenes that are required. This is also a direct MCQ in your exam, E6 role and E7 role. Now, there are another two genes which are present here, L1 and L2. Why I am telling you about this? Because this is the target of the vaccine, L1, that is the major capsid protein. So now what do you do in HPV DNA testing? Same procedure. Patient will lie down in dorsal position. You will take this brush. You can see this is the hybrid capture vial and this is the brush. You will take this scraping. Again, this part, this pointed part will go inside the endocervix and this part will take this scraping from the ectocervix, right? Once you put it in the bottle, the only difference is that you will put it here and this brush will break from here. Okay, so just shake and snap is what is done in the HPV DNA testing. Since they are very fond of asking you photos and images in these exams, you should be familiar with these vials and brushes. So now what is the use of HPV DNA testing? I told you one is it is that is used for screening. Okay, so it is a preferred method of primary screening. This age group and all I will explain to you later. Then it can be used in the management of women. See, I should tell you one thing here. Now, you must have seen PAPs, you have done PAP smear, then reports will come to you. It might come as an NILM, negative for intraepithelial lesion or malignancy. Or it might show some squamous abnormalities. Or it might show some glandular abnormalities. Right? So, this detailed classification is known as the Bethesda classification, which I will discuss with you in detail tomorrow, right? But if you look at this, in the squamous, you will see ASCUS, that is atypical squamous cells of undetermined significance. You might see ASCH, that is high grade lesion cannot be ruled out. You might see LCIL, low grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. You might see HCIL, high grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. So these are the various results that can come out. Similarly, in glandular, you might see AGC, that is atypical glandular cells or atypical endometrial cells. So now in the management of these, you will need HPV DNA. So HPV DNA has been used for triaging the management of ASCUS cytology. You know this word triage? You must have heard in trauma, right? Where you will have your red, yellow, green and black triage will be there depending upon the emergency care that is required immediately or within 30 minutes or 1 hour, like that. Similarly, once you have got the ASCUS report, what should you do? That will be governed by this HPV DNA testing. Then next, HPV DNA testing is also used for follow-up of patients with CIN because HPV is more sensitive. Right, I told you that the PAP cytology is sensitivity is not that high, it is only up to 60%. But HPV DNA has a very good sensitivity which may go up to 80 to 85%. Right, but specificity is lower. So, since it is more sensitive and a patient has already been treated for CIN, you want to pick her up early if there is any recurrence of the lesion, therefore, you can use HPV DNA testing. I have written here primary screening age greater than 25 years. This is a little contradictory for you and also for a lot of your textbooks which say that HPV DNA should only be used after 30 years. This is a very recent change, right? FDA has approved HPV DNA testing for primary screening in the age group more than 25 years. But let us not confuse ourselves here. We'll first clarify what are the major guidelines and then I will tell you about what is the recent change that has happened. So I told you that HPV has come in, but always HPV will not persist. It depends upon the characteristics, like if she is a multiparous woman, she is using OCP, she is smoking, she has HIV or other STDs, then there is an increased chance of developing cervical cancer. So again, let us clarify. I told you just a quick revision. HPV has come in the normal cervix. It is clearing out in 80 to 90%. Here it is not clearing out and there are some mild cytological abnormalities which are developing. At this stage, the HPV DNA can be detected and you can put this HPV DNA for testing, right? So that is the whole purpose of doing HPV DNA testing. These are the different types of tests that are available, the hybrid capture 2 and the CERVISTA test, right? So this is the stage at which DNA can be detected. Now, whether DNA will only tell you that yes, that the virus is present. Now, whether this virus is replicating or not, or whether it has integrated into the host cell or not, whether it is actually going to cause the disease or not, cannot be told just on the basis of DNA, right? For that, you need to know that the virus is active inside the body and persisting inside the body. So E6E7, that is your oncogene mRNA, will tell you yes, that the disease is persisting and now this lady is at a greater risk of developing further higher grade of lesions and cancer. So there is an HPV RNA testing also, and further, now after once transcription has happened from DNA to RNA, what will happen? Translation will happen and there is going to be production of your E6 and E7 proteins. So for this, you have a separate test, that is the AVANTAGE test, where you are testing for the protein. So what I mean to tell you in this slide is, see, DNA is there, good, it tells you that the virus has infected, but it doesn't tell you whether it is going to persist and is it going to replicate or not. If there is an E6, E7 RNA, that means yes, now oncogenesis has started. E6, E7 protein, it means oncogenesis has started. I'm telling you so much in detail because they are very fond of asking you questions from this topic. This is a very upcoming topic and a high yield topic. So this might give you an extra edge, an extra one mark in your next exam. So last of the screening modality is co-testing. Co-testing is nothing but cytology and HPV DNA testing put together, right? What is the benefit? The benefit is that the sensitivity increases. See, cytology individually, it has a sensitivity of only 55 to 60%. Whereas HPV DNA has a higher sensitivity going up to 80 to 85%. Okay. But HPV DNA has a lower specificity, whereas this has a higher specificity. So, actually putting together will increase the accuracy of the test. Right. This is a little bit PSM type, sensitivity, specificity, accuracy. Then comes frequency. If you are putting two tests together, you can decrease the frequency of testing. See, calling a woman again and again for screening is not so easy because the woman is bound to be lost to follow. So if you are putting these two tests together, you can increase the duration, decrease the duration of frequency from 3 years to 5 years. Okay. Now, we did why to screen, we did how to screen, now we come to when to screen. See, you start only at the age greater than 21 years, you won't start less than that, irrespective of the age of sexual activity. Okay. Now, cytology alone. I told you in 21 to 29 years, we don't do HPV DNA, we only do cytology. Yes, I am contradicting myself from my last slide, I'll clarify it here. 21 to 29 years, we will do a 3-yearly pap smear. We don't do a HPV DNA in this age group. Why? Because the chance of HPV infection is very high in this age group. Almost 90% of women will be exposed to HPV when they have their sexual contact. But 80 to 90% will also clear out that infection in 18 months or 2 years at the max. So if we are going to test for HPV, so many women will come positive, then we have to investigate, we have to further treat. So it is unnecessary overdiagnosis. That's why in the 21 to 29 age group, we only use pap smear, right? Then comes your co-testing. I told you that is pap plus HPV DNA. In the 21 to 29 years age group, it should not be used. Reason I just specified. In the 30 to 65 age group, this is the preferred method because here the frequency is 5 yearly and it has a better sensitivity and specificity. But if you don't have the HPV DNA test available with you because of the cost issues or the logistics issues, then you can do an acceptable method, that is cytology alone every 3 years. Okay. Now, when do you stop? A lady who is more than 65 years. See, you know what is the age group for CA cervix? Generally, it is at its bimodal. One is your 35 to 39 and one is again in your 50s. So, in a woman who is more than 65 years and she has still not developed CA cervix, very unlikely that now she will develop. But provided she has an adequate negative prior screening test. So, what do I mean by this? That an adequate negative screening test. Basically, it means that in the last 10 years, we should have done adequate screening for her, right? Which all came out to be negative. Now, if it was in the form of cytology, it will be 3 negative cytology. If it is in the form of HPV DNA and cytology put together, that is co-testing, then it will be 2 co-testing. And the last investigation should have been done at least in the last 5 years. In this case, we can simply stop. Then there are certain special situations. If a lady has undergone total hysterectomy, why I have written total? Because if she has undergone subtotal, that is the cervix is still remaining, you need to continue screening as the normal schedule. But if cervix is also removed and patient never had any history of CIN ever, CIN 2 or higher, then you don't need to do any screening, you can stop. But if she had a history of CIN 2 plus in the past, then you have to do cytology alone every 3 years for 20 years. Okay. After HPV vaccination, very important, you cannot stop the screening. It's same like after COVID vaccination, you cannot stop wearing a mask. Same, after HPV vaccination, you still have to continue screening. One more special situation I should tell you about immunocompromised women. In immunocompromised women, they are the only women where you will do annual screening, right? Otherwise, annual screening, none of the societies tell you for annual screening in normal healthy women. They only tell you about annual screening in immunocompromised women, right? Because they are at greater risk of progression of the CIN2 cancer. So, let's go to the next thing. Screen and treat. What is screen and treat? So you did a VIA, you did a VILI, either whichever one you have done. And now you are seeing that yes, there is some abnormal area and you have a cryotherapy machine with you. You do a cryo then and there, right? This can be done in one sitting. It is very ideal for low resource settings where you know that the woman might not follow up, that there is an increased loss to follow up, or you do not have any much other colposcopy and biopsy provisions with you. The only disadvantage is that there is a risk of over-treatment. You might treat some women which are having actually benign or insignificant insignificant lesions which you are treating. That is the screen and treat. It is recommended in low resource settings where you are not sure about the follow-up of the woman. So now I've put one big picture for you. See, again, I told you normal cervix. This is very similar to the first figure I showed you. Normal cervix, HPV infected, persistent infections, CIN 2, 3, high-risk lesions, invasive cancer. See, it is taking so much time. We have so much time to intervene. These are the same persistent factors I told you. Young age, multiple sexual partners, multiparity, high-risk HPV infection, STDs, smoking, right? Poor immunity, OCUs, everything. Finally, when the HPV has high grade to invasive cancer, your genomic instability and various oncogene activation will be there. Where all can you intervene? You can intervene at multiple steps here, right? You can intervene here, you can intervene here, you can intervene here, you can also intervene here. So, one is by screening, one, okay, first you screened, you diagnosed a low grade lesion or a high grade lesion, you treat that lesion, then that is a way of prevention of invasive cancer, right? Second method is you can intervene with a vaccine. prophylactic vaccine. Everybody was talking about vaccine till a month back, right? We started vaccination in India on 16 January for COVID. Similarly, now you must remember this vaccine also, prophylactic vaccine, right? Let us go into details of this prophylactic vaccine in the next coming slides. So I told you effective screening, appropriate management, prophylactic vaccines. Then I have written some other things, modification of reproductive factors, that is like multiparity, low parity is will reduce the risk of CSRV. Safe sexual practices. What do I mean to say by this? Barrier contraceptive use. Good personal hygiene. All these will prevent CA cervix. Most important are your first two, that is effective screening and appropriate management. It is not that you diagnose and then the woman is lost. She has to be treated for it. Second is your vaccine. A vaccine is also a very hot favorite topic for the questions in your exams. So let us look at the prophylactic vaccines. The first is Cervarix. This was the first to be launched in the market. It's a bivalent vaccine, right? It was against the two serotypes 16 and 18. Okay, these I told you they are the most oncogenic. They are responsible for 70% of all CA cervix. This is Cervarix. When do you give it? Three doses, 0, 1 and 6. 0 is day to day, 1 month later, 6 months later. Or if you are giving it to younger girls, teenage girls, then 2 doses are sufficient and that can be given 6 months apart, right? The age group that it has been approved is for 10 to 45 years. Now let me tell you some things here. The ideal age group for vaccinating is young teenage girl, right? That is 10 to 14 years, or some books say 9 to 14 years is the age group that we should vaccinate. It is approved for 10 to 45 years. Initially, there was a number 26 in between also, right? That it was approved from 10 to 26 years, then it has been removed and now the approval has been extended to 45 years. So this is one change that has happened. So you should remember this new age group, 45 years. Okay. So if you are immunizing in the young teenage girl, you need to give 2 doses because the immune response mounted is higher and 2 doses will be sufficient. But if you are immunizing an older woman, then you have to give 3 doses. Now again, you'll ask me if I'm immunizing a 30-year-old woman or 35-year-old woman, she might already be sexually exposed, she might already have children also, what is the benefit? See, yes, you are correct. If we are immunizing a lady who has never been sexually active, then the efficacy of the vaccine is very high. It may be as good as 90%, and see here I've written 98% against CIN2. Okay. But if you are immunizing a woman who has already been sexually active or already exposed to HPV, this efficacy will drop down significantly to 44%. But still, some protection is better than no protection, and that's why this approval has been extended. Next came in the market, that was Gardasil, that is a quadrivalent vaccine. It is active against 6, 11, 16, 18, right? Approved in the same age group, 9 to 45 years. It is again given 0 to 6 or 0 and 6 in young teenage girls. Now, the efficacy is very good. You are seeing here that there are 2 extra virus types which are added here, 6 and 11. So, what is the benefit of this? This is going to prevent genital warts as well. It is also going to prevent your vulval intraepithelial neoplasia, vaginal intraepithelial neoplasia and genital warts. So this is the added advantage of Gardasil. Efficacy is very good. Side effects are very less. You should be telling to everybody around you. You find any young teenage girl, you find anybody who's asking about this vaccine, after seeing the advertisement, you should be telling them to get these vaccines. Then came a newer vaccine, that is the Gardasil 9. That is the nonavalent vaccine. It has the 4 components of Gardasil, original one, 6, 11, 16, 18, and next another 5 are added. Now it is difficult to remember these numbers, but you must, because this was asked in the AIIMS exam, 31, 33, 45, 52, 58. The only way of remembering this is at looking at it again and again, because otherwise it is very difficult to remember all these numbers. So the age group that is affected is 9 to 45 years. The dosage that has to be given is 0, 1 and 6, right? Same. It is also active against cervical, vulval, vaginal and genital warts. Now, I want to tell you a few other things about these vaccines here. They are effective against cervical cancer. Very good. They are effective against genital warts. They are also effective against vulval and vaginal cancer. Similarly, they are effective against anal cancer and penile cancer in men also. That is the reason why in many countries, not in India, but in many countries, these vaccines are also allowed to be given to males also. And in the same age group, from 9 to 45, they have been approved in many countries. So, if the one of the options might mention that it can be given to boys, so yes, it is true that it can be given to boys. Another point I wanted to tell you about HPV is, HPV not only causes these anogenital cancers, HPV is also responsible for cancers of the head and neck. So another MCQ option might come that it is responsible for some other cancer, like the cancer of the pharynx, which is very right, because it is a very important component of cancer of the oropharynx. So you should be very thorough with these two topics, HPV and prophylactic vaccines, and pap smear as your base. So now I've given you one PSM MCQ here, that is prevention. WHO has given a new target to achieve by 2030, right? And it says that 90% of, it is easy to remember, 90, 70 and 90, target by 2030. 90 is 90% of girls should be fully vaccinated. You all have a role to play. You MBBS undergraduates, interns, PG graduates, everybody has a role to get all these girls vaccinated. 70% of women should be screened using a high performance test. And out of this 70%, 90% should, those who are identified with cervical disease should be treated. That's why it is known as 90, 70, 90. It is the new thing. It can come in as a MCQ, either as a part of PSM or of gynecology. Now, next is colposcopy. I told you first only, colposcopy is not a part, a screening modality. It is used for further investigations. It is a diagnostic modality. It is basically a sophisticated magnifying glass. You must have seen the colposcope in your OPD. Okay, here is the telescope. You can visualize through here, and it has a focal length of 25 to 30 centimeters. So the distance between the camera and the cervix is 25 to 30 centimeters, and it will give you a magnified view, which is 6 to 15 times magnified. The procedure is the same. You will use your Cusco speculum. Put in the Cusco speculum. I have put the pictures for you here for you. You'll put in the Cusco speculum, you'll pass in your, you'll put your colposcope, position it, adjust it according to your vision, and then you will use some normal saline to clean the cervix, remove all the mucus and all. When you are examining it under magnification and light, you can easily appreciate the blood vessels nicely, right? So, once you have appreciated, you can there is also a green filter in that which will help you appreciate the blood vessels better. You can visualize the blood vessels, then you can go in for again, you will do your VIA, that is, you will apply 3 to 5% acetic acid, visualize the acetovite areas, then you will put in your Lugol's iodine, you will see what is the area that is not turning mahogany brown, right? And you will see the suspicious area, that is the acetovite area, the mustard yellow area, and you will take a biopsy. This is the biopsy forceps, right? So I told you the steps of colposcopy. It is what? It is a sophisticated visualization of the cervix, right? First thing, you will put in your Cusco speculum, okay? Clean with normal saline, okay? Visualize, see any abnormal vessels are there. What are the abnormal vessels? You might see a mosaic pattern. You might see dot, dot, dot punctate vessels, right? You might see some acute branching, looping of vessels. Then you will go and do a, visualization under acetic acid. Then you will put in your Lugol's iodine. Once all this is done, you will take a suspicious areas are there, that is your acetovite and your mustard yellow areas, and you will take a biopsy from that, right? So today I have told you everything about all the screening tests that are available and how to prevent CA cervix. Now these screening tests will lead to certain diagnosis of CIN. That we will discuss in detail tomorrow in my next class on management of CIN tomorrow at 7:30. So thanks a lot for listening. And again, let me tell you, you should use my code Dr. Deepika and get the Iconic or the Plus package on an Academy so that you have continuous access to all our lectures or many, many wonderful educators. You can also find us on Telegram, YouTube. You can subscribe to us, like us, hit the bell icon, right? See you all tomorrow at 7:30. Thank you.